From the studios of Farm Journal Broadcast, this is Ag Day.
The tradition continues. See who will be handing out that cold glass of milk in the winner's circle at this year's Indy 500. Farmers are feeling the pain of higher fertilizer prices, but could relief be in sight?
We're actually seeing a few things that are leaning towards prices going down.
As new sticker shock emerges on prices at the pump, what's behind the latest spike? Right now on Ag Day. Good morning, I'm Clinton Griffiths. Gas and diesel prices have hit record highs, and now there are concerns those prices could go even higher. AAA reporting the average national price for a gallon of regular unleaded shot up to $4.37 a gallon on Tuesday, and that wipes out the record hit just back in March of $4.33. Diesel prices also sending shockwaves, hitting $5.55 a gallon yesterday. And that diesel price being watched very closely by farmers right now since it powers so much of the equipment in the industry. So what's behind the increase in prices right now? Peter Meyer of S&P Global Commodity Insights telling us diesel supply is short all over the world due to sanctions against Russia combined with demand bouncing back following the pandemic. And with supplies at the New York Harbor, a major hub for diesel distribution, now at a 30-year low. In the U.S., Meyer says it's not a shortage of oil, it's a shortage of refining capacity on the East Coast. Right now, the U.S. exports more than 1 million barrels of distillates every day to countries such as Mexico, Brazil, and Chile. So could an export ban be coming for diesel fuel? AgriTalk host Chip Flory putting that question to Farm Journal Washington analyst Jim Wiesmeyer during this week's Signal the Noise.
I will never rule anything out in this economic and political environment, Chip, but I don't see it at this particular time, not yet. And I think that there would be officials within the National Economic Council and elsewhere arguing against that. But again, I hate to play both sides. I'm not going to rule it out.
Now, market watchers are concerned gas prices could even reach $4.50 a gallon in the next week or so as the imbalance between supply and demand around the world continues to grow ahead of the summer driving season. But the one bit of good news for diesel prices may be the fact that demand for heating oil is diminishing due to the rapid rise in temperatures. The cool, wet spring weather is having a huge impact on spring fertilizer demand. That's as some are concerned with what impact fertilizer prices and the late planting season will both have on crop yields this year. S&P Global Platts creating these graphics that show you just how much fertilizer prices have skyrocketed since last spring. Josh Linville follows the fertilizer markets closely. He says the late spring means that supply chain system is getting jammed up due to the expectations for an early spring just a few months ago. And the lack of spring fertilizer application is actually weighing on prices recently. And now some farmers with a short window to plant are forced with the decision to apply spring anhydrous like planned or just go ahead and plant without. That's along with expectations for an uptick in prevent plant acres in North and South Dakota. That means that fertilizer prices could continue to see extreme volatility. Andy says, with so much changing by the day, it's too early to forecast even higher nitrogen prices by next spring.
But what that doesn't take into account is it's been a poor spring. We expect that we're going to carry a lot more physical inventory into the summertime, which is going to weigh on price ideas. We are actually seeing international price ideas of anhydrous falling, which is going to weigh on North America price ideas. We're actually seeing a few things that are leaning towards prices going down. Now, all that gets thrown out the window if all of a sudden corn jumps to $9, $10 a bushel, right? It's a whole new ballgame.
France announcing Tuesday it's planning to cut its corn acreage this season due to high fertilizer cost. It's expected to sow just 3.6 million acres, down 6% year over year. More of those acres will go to oil seeds. And higher prices could factor into the latest supply and demand numbers being released from USDA tomorrow. The report will be the first outlook for the crops that will be harvested this fall. Now that includes forecasts for yields, production, exports, and prices. They say to come up with a yield forecast, they will be using historical trend yield models, but those will be tempered by planting progress and input costs.
Even though the crop hasn't in many cases been planted yet. Corn and soybeans being sold from that crop already, so we have that to look at.
The USDA forecast will be released at noon Eastern time on Thursday, and we will bring you a complete coverage and analysis online and on air. Planting could start to pick up with heat coming to the middle of the country. Meteorologist Andrew Whitmire joins us with an update. Andrew?
And yes, we really are going to really start to heat things up across the country as this upper level ridge really begins to cripple parts of the plains and Midwest Great Lakes states. As this upper level ridge really does begin to build on in, we're calling it a heat dome as this high pressure moves on in here. We're looking at very hot temperatures heading our way. And as we take a look at those high temperatures for today, check out St. Louis there. Could be nearing that triple digit heat mark, crossing over to that century mark of over 100 degrees. And even outside of that, it's going to feel like the deep tropics across much of the plains, Midwestern and Great Lakes states today, with those dew points getting up into the upper 60s, lower 70s. Check out Omaha, Tulsa, Dallas, well up into the 90s. Going forward into tomorrow morning, it's going to still feel like summer out there tomorrow morning. Lots of 60s across the heartland of the country. And then as we take a look at the afternoon time frame, we still got plenty of 90s and 80s across the plains, Midwestern states. Eventually, though, we're going to start to see that cooling trend heading our direction across much of the eastern half of the U.S. as we head towards the latter half of this week. And planting season is getting underway at Indiana Tom Farms in Leesburg, sharing this video saying they've been waiting for a week like this. They say they were finally able to plant their sweet corn patch. Kim Tom is the CEO of Tom Farms, and he shot this video. You'll remember he served as the U.S. ambassador to the U.N. agencies for food and agriculture. I'll have more on your AgDay forecast coming up.
Spring planting is happening in Ukraine, but at a much different pace than a year ago. According to the country's ag minister, so far farmers there have sown roughly 17.2 million acres of spring crops this year. That's 25% to 30% less than the same time last year. However, the minister admits the work has likely been lower quality. The planted acres for corn will be smaller than in years past. Meanwhile, the ministry is saying the country exported more than 1 million metric tons of grain in April via Romania, adding it could get more difficult as Romania and Bulgaria crops reach harvest in a couple of months. Happening right now, Ukrainian officials say Russian missiles pummeled the vital port of Odessa, apparently as part of efforts to disrupt supply lines. In an effort to keep ag flowing out of the country, Ukraine is currently in talks with Poland and Lithuania as routes for summer grain harvest. The Wall Street Journal reporting that to ship Ukraine's wheat to global markets, the countries are considering making several seed ports available. Now, those countries are also looking to make space for sunflower oil, as Ukraine is the world's biggest producer. Getting product to those countries may be the bigger issue, as Ukraine's rail network has seen extensive damage in the war. The world seems to need wheat, but getting a crop in the ground has been difficult. We'll have details next. And later, we're off to the races with Indiana Dairy as one farmer prepares to deliver on a tradition at the Indy 500.
Find farm equipment on Machinery Pete's May 17th online auction. No reserve, no buyer fees. Start bidding now at auctions.machinerypete.com.
Tyson Foods is reporting soaring profits as the company raised prices for beef, chicken, and pork, citing higher costs. Now, the company said it increased prices for beef by an average of 23.8%, while its chicken prices increased 14.4% and 10.8% for pork. Now, Tyson said its cost of goods sold increased by 15% over the quarter, as the company paid more for animal feed, freight, and labor expenses. Now, Tyson's chief executive officer said the price increases are consistent with inflation. Joining us today, we have Steve Georgie with Allendale Incorporated. Steve, we know the wheat market has been pretty strong here given what's going on with Russia and Ukraine. A lot of folks looking forward to spring wheat planting this year, but boy, they're off to a pretty tough start.
They are. You know, when you look at just the all the turmoil that we've seen up in the Dakotas, North Dakota still a very, very big problem, you know, and you look at what we have as far as more rain coming. They've got another inch of rain over the next week as well, something that these guys do not need up there. And so it is a big, big problem. talking with one of our offices up near Fargo, it is a mess, and it's going to be. So what are we going to do? Will we see acreage slip? Are we going to see them kind of abandon those acres and move them into corn, maybe even into beans? You know, it depends. And if this rain is going to continue, this is going to be a big problem. A second crop, you know, a lot of guys talking preventative plant, whether or not we're going to see preventative plant up there. It could happen, and it is such a problem that we need to be very aware of that. These spring wheat, the spring wheat acres and spring wheat trying to go in right now is struggling. We know it. The Minneapolis wheat contract really not reflecting some of the issues we have, but I think that's more because we haven't seen demand yet for wheat. If we start seeing demand here in the U.S., could be something that can be very friendly moving forward, but we need to see what happens. The next week to 2 weeks there, very, very detrimental that we actually see things dry out and we can get guys in the fields again. A lot of problems up there in North Dakota.
What about Canada? Obviously, they grow a lot of spring wheat as well. What do their numbers look like?
Yeah, so StatsCan came out with their numbers. You had the market before they even came out with the numbers, very, very strong and continuing to be that way. They did come out with some very friendly numbers, and so they did show that those numbers, that there is a problem up in Canada as well. So it's the question is, when do we see the demand shift, right? If Canada's got a problem, U.S. has a problem, you start hearing rumors out there that India is not going to export wheat or put some kind of, you know, number on what they are going to export. And then then they come back and say that we're not. When do we see the demand shift to the U.S.? And I think that is what the market's kind of waiting for. But these problems are real. I feel for those farmers up there and certainly feel for those issues that they're dealing with. So, but Canada supported the idea that their wheat is not as good as well. And so still very bullish market, or can be anyway, if we start seeing demand pile in as well.
All right. Well, it'll be something we'll continue to watch. Thank you so much, Steve. Sure appreciate you being here on Ag Day. We'll be back with more coming up.
To talk to Steve Georgie one-on-one, call Allendale Incorporated at 800-262-7538 or head online to allendale-inc.com.
The 2022 Atlantic hurricane season is nearing, and now the National Hurricane Center has released this year's storm names. The names are used in rotation and recycled every 6 years or so. This year's list will be used again in 2028. Now, the only time there is a change in the list is if a storm is so deadly or costly that the future use of its name would be inappropriate. Researchers are predicting a more active hurricane season than usual, calling for at least 19 named storms and 9 hurricanes. The season officially starts on June 1st. And Andrew, that starts pretty soon. I mean, that'll be here before we know it, but
we do
have some severe weather for kind of spring severe weather season popping up maybe today or tomorrow.
Yeah, what's really been ongoing throughout much of May and parts of April is, again, a severe weather season across the Plain States, and we're going to continue to see this build as that heat and humidity continues to work its way further off to the east. And yes, we still have that severe risk for today, but as we zoom on up towards the northern portion of the plains, the Red River Valley and much of western Minnesota, they're going to have some severe storms heading through that as we head on into a Thursday with damaging hail, wind, even the possibility of a few isolated tornadoes. And as we take a look at the future projection here onto a future track, you'll notice how this low pressure system begins to dig out of the central portions there of the Rockies. And as that warm front tries to lift northward across the Dakotas and Minnesota, that's again where we could be looking at a few stronger storms as we head on into a Thursday. Meanwhile, again, watching these two areas of high pressure that continues to dominate much of the plains and Midwest, Great Lakes states here. And again, that's really going to allow that heat to really build on up. And as we take a look at the afternoon time frame for Thursday, again, still all eyes on that cold front that will continue to spawn a few more scattered showers further south into Minnesota. Meanwhile, this low pressure system up across the Pacific Northwest with that cold front, that's going to eventually end out this hot and humid weather that has been ongoing across the parts of the Plain States. And look at this precipitation estimate. You notice those brighter colors up to the north. And that's all thanks to those scattered showers and thunderstorms. Meanwhile, still looking at some drier times for the Ohio River Valley, Tennessee, Ohio Valley, as much as the desert southwest. Really not seeing much of the rain. We'll likely start to see more precipitation, though, picking up across the Pacific Northwest. And there is even a little bit of wintry side with that cold front that will come through late in the week here. Look at some mountain snow that could be potentially coming our direction, where we could be looking at some of those snowfall rates across the Intermountain West, picking up close to near a foot of snow throughout this upcoming weekend. Let's take a look a little closer at home. Berkeley, sunny and hot, high 92 degrees. Low temperature there, 72 degrees. Not much relief from the heat and humidity. Watertown, South Dakota, mostly sunny, scattered showers and thunderstorms. Fallon, Nevada, increasing sunshine.
When beauty becomes a beast to manage, we'll discuss a budding invasive species next on Weed Wednesday. And later, the winter circle wouldn't be complete without an ice cold glass of milk. We're off to the farm preparing to deliver at the Indy 500 in the country.
It's time to sign up for the 2022 United Pork Americas Conference in Orlando, Florida. Register today at unitedporkamericas.com and join us September 7th through the 9th. Ag Day is brought to you by Authority Supreme Herbicide from FMC. Learn more at ag.fmc.com.
It's a commonly planted landscape shade tree that usually is in full bloom this time of year, but what was once thought to be an ornamental, low-maintenance decoration is now getting banned in some states. Purdue Extension takes a look at the negative effects of the Bradford pear trees on today's Weed Wednesday.
The Cali pear was initially imported from Asia to test as a rootstock for the common pear.
Cali pear was and continues to be planted for its reddish purple hue in the fall time and its beautiful white flowers that come in early spring.
One of the only noticeable drawbacks is the stench of rotting fish that is present when the tree is flowering in early spring. Another drawback of the Cali pear is its weak branching pattern, as seen here, especially in the popular Bradford pear cultivar. This causes its limbs to break under heavy ice and snow load. Despite the foul smell and the weak branches, Cali pear cultivars are still being used today in many cases to replace the American elm as America's street tree of choice. While most Cali pear cultivars are sterile, they can produce viable seeds when they mix with another Cali pear cultivar. For example, a Bradford pear and another Bradford pear cannot produce viable seeds. However, a Bradford pear and a White House pear can produce viable seeds. This has allowed the Cali pear to spread from here to here in our native forests and ecosystems. In many sites, Cali pear forms thickets, like this one, that choke out native vegetation and limit wildlife habitat. Invasive Cali pear is often thorny, fast-growing, and an abundant fruit producer. These fruits are readily eaten by birds, which spread the seed and start new infestations.
It's holding back regeneration, the native regeneration. It's definitely physically inhibiting the oak and the hickory and the other valuable species to the ecosystem.
The full effects of Cali pear is still being studied, but one thing is clear. The Cali pear problem will not go away without proper management. So we encourage you to stop planting Cali pear and plant native alternatives such as downy serviceberry or the flowering dogwood.
All right, thanks for that. Up next, a Memorial Day tradition continues. See how one Indiana dairy farmer will find his way to the winner's circle at the Indy 500. Next. A great tradition will once again take place Memorial Day weekend in Indiana. The tradition of the winner of the Indy 500 drinking some milk in the winner's circle. And here's a preview of this year's Indiana dairy producer who will be making that ceremonial handoff. This year's milk person is Tim Haynes of Garrett, Indiana. Now, Tim's grandfather started Superior Dairy in the 1940s, and the farm has not been without cows since. But the technology they use has changed. Now, Tim has a smart barn where temperature is regulated by automatic fans, sprinklers, and curtains. Cows choose when they want to get milked with robots and spend the rest of their day lounging on sand beds with access to ample food and water thanks to a feed robot. So make sure to watch out for Tim handing over that iconic glass bottle of ice cold milk to the winner on race day. Now it's estimated over 250,000 people will be watching in person and millions more worldwide. And that's all of our time today. Thank you for watching. From all of us here at AgDay, I'm Clinton Griffiths. Have a great night. Have fun.